Okay, so I'm Álvaro Martínez, and I'm also interested in oxidative stress, how to model oxidative stress, and how it affects with oxygen. Why I'm interested in this, so oxidative stress is associated with a lot of pathological conditions and with the aging process in general. And redox signaling in itself is an essential homeostatic mechanism to maintain normal physiology. And there's evidence, there's correlative evidence that in the tissues that develop oxidative stress, whether in pathology or part of the natural aging process, they also develop dysfunctional redox signaling. And I've tried to model oxidative stress for the most part in vitro using a C2C12 myotube cell line. And during that part of my project, I gathered a lot of data. But I'm going to talk mainly about some kind of tampering I've been doing with Copassive lately. So within redox signaling, I'm interested in the NRF2-KEAP1 redox signaling pathway. This is the major regulator of both the basal and induced antioxidant response in many cellular models. And basically, the way this pathway works is that when you get an increase in the levels of reactive oxygen species, this leads to a pathway response of an increase in the accumulation of the transcription factor NRF2 in the nucleus. And this happens to the interference of reactive oxygen species with the inhibitor of NRF2 called KEAP1. Now, at the basal state, there's a negative regulatory axis mediated by GSK3 beta, which promotes the exclusion of NRF2 from the nucleus and subsequent degradation. And this negative regulatory axis is actually inhibited under the presence of reactive oxygen species to prolong the response. And there's actually quite a lot of controversy on various aspects of these pathways, of this pathway, namely, for example, the relative importance of different phosphorylation events in the cytosol, in the nucleus, also which is the main negative regulator of nuclear NRF2 levels. Some people argue CSK3 beta, some people argue it's FIN, some people argue it's the KEAP1 inhibitor. And the perspective we're approaching on this kind of uncertainty is the fact that this pathway, at least the knowledge we have on this pathway, resembles somewhat a coherent type 4 network motif, where reactive oxygen species inhibit the KEAP1 inhibitor, which is actively inhibiting NRF2 transcription factor, and then further activates it to the inhibition of this negative regulatory pathway. So perhaps we don't need to know the intricate detail of this pathway. Perhaps just by knowing its overall structure, we can get some useful insights into its overall behavior and its dynamics. So about 10 years ago, the way the NRF2 pathway was thought to operate was that basically this is very similar to the diagram I showed you before. This is the negative regulatory axis. And reactive oxygen species essentially disrupt a complex which is formed when the NRF2 transcription factor is bound by the KEAP1 inhibitor. And upon this this interaction between reactive oxygen species and the complex, NRF2 detaches and goes to the nucleus. So this was the traditional view, which has now largely been discarded. And this is the existing model adopted by the field, where NRF2 transcription factor synthesized constitutively and will bind its inhibitor to form the complex, so same as the other one. The only difference now is that upon oxidation of the complex by reactive oxygen species, the complex changes conformation, and then KEAP1 stops being recycled, and so NRF2 just accumulates and goes to the nucleus. And so we just captured these two different formalisms into different very simple models in Copassi. And actually, we didn't want to make explicit assumptions on which was the main negative regulator of nuclear levels of NRF2. We just assumed it depended on the levels of GSK3 beta, as shown in the literature. And this is because previous experiments we've done where we treated cell lines with extracellular doses of hydrogen peroxide, so it's an acute addition, which I shall refer to as a bolus, we see no change in any of the negative regulators of NRF2, at least the ones that have been argued in the literature. So we just, you know, assumed it's an unknown rate that happens, you know, within a certain timescale. And within this data that we had gathered originally, we had a few time courses. So we used this to perform parameter estimations on these two simple models. And this is just an example of the output that the parameter estimation in Compassi can give you. And we were quite pleased to see that the only model that fitted the data was the conformational cycling model, which is the one that's accepted by the community. So it was quite assuring to see that even within this quite simple network topology, it's still enough to very clearly discriminate between both of these alternative topologies. And this is just an example of the simulation output the model can produce. So when we simulate an extracellular addition of hydrogen peroxide in the model, which gets scavenged by the cells, and this results in an intracellular accommodation of hydrogen peroxide with this profile, which is again which is the case, and it results in an oxidation of complex here in green and a more gradual accumulation of nuclear in RF2 here. So then we just did a very simple test within the model. We wanted to understand, okay, well, what happens if we just raise the levels of reactive oxygen species within the model that are being produced at rest, and then on top of this, you add the redox signal, so the hydrogen peroxide in this case. So we can see here in the left, left for intracellular hydrogen peroxide, as you increase the level of reactive oxygen species production at rest, and by increasing this parameter here in a parameter scan, and then you add the redox signal, you can see the peak shifts up by roughly the same that the basal level is being shifted up by the change in this parameter. So, you know, suggesting there's an additive effect in intracellular hydrogen peroxide, nothing really too exciting. When we look at nuclear NRF2, we see that when this pathway reaches a level of activation, which is in the same order of magnitude as that is caused by an acute addition of hydrogen peroxide, so the redox signal itself, it's basically reaching the limits of pathways, of the limits of sensing by this pathway, so it cannot really be further activated. And then when we were actually doing the experiments in our in vitro model for oxidative stress, we did observe this, where here we're treating cells with an acute addition of extracellular hydrogen peroxide, which is the bolus, this one here. And then with these four columns, we're increasing, we're treating the cells with a steady state concentration of hydrogen peroxide over 24 hours. And then as we increase the steady state treatment, we see that the NRF2 activation reaches a magnitude which is similar to that caused by an acute addition, but not further. And when we actually further explore this by combining the treatment, so first we treat with a steady-state hydrogen peroxide for 24 hours, and then we add the acute hydrogen peroxide stimulus, we initially see an additive effect. So this is the steady-state, low steady-state first, then you add the bolus and you get an additive effect, and then you increase the steady-state, add the acute treatment, and this additive effect disappears. And we see exactly the same thing if we increase, if we double the concentration of the acute hydrogen peroxide treatment to 100 micromolar. So that was pleasing to see. And then we asked another type of question. So when we do these kind of treatments in our cells, we're actually exposing the cells to extracellular hydrogen peroxide, which is fundamentally quite different to the nature of the oxidative stress that occurs in vivo, where all of the sources of hydrogen peroxide are already inside the cell, so you don't have a prolonged flux or diffusion. And then we just wanted to observe if we change this in the model so that the reactive oxygen species production was inside the cell, would this affect our observations? So this is the profile I showed you before, where reactive oxygen species production is extracellular because it, we aim to model experiments. And here we see the same effect when the sources of reactive oxygen species or hydrogen peroxide are intracellularly, but regrettably you can't really appreciate it because the axes are not clear. But this time scale is much shorter than this one. So actually, if I was to use the same axis scale, this profile would look like a spark. And this has some important implications, as it's also a few papers have come out recently that argue when we examine redox signaling by treating cells with extracellular doses of hydrogen peroxide, the result of this is a systemic pushing of the redox transcription factors into the nucleus in a timescale and magnitude that is not really realistic. It's quite artificial. So actually, a better way to study redox signaling would be to trigger endogenous reactive oxygen species generation by the use of drugs like urotensin 2 or other NADPH oxidase activators. So basically, my story today is not necessarily like a groundbreaking piece of biology or some ingenious use of a modeling method. It's really to prove that actually computational modeling through COPAS in particular is powerful enough that you can actually use it to probe the model you're looking at, to get an idea of the behavior of your system without necessarily having to embark in a very lengthy systems biology iteration of model calibration and validation prediction, etc., etc. It's very useful to do, to make what in physics is known as toy models to better understand your system and inform the experimental design. So with that, I would like to acknowledge all the people I work with, my funding bodies, and all of you for listening. Thank you.